Kia ora te iwi, hoki mai anō. As you saw in our story, Kiwi Abbas Nazari fled the Taliban and found safety as a refugee in Aotearoa. He has just returned from the United States, where he completed a Fulbright scholarship in security studies, and he watched closely this week as the Taliban swiftly reclaimed control of Afghanistan. Abbas is with us this morning. Kia ora, thank you for being with us. Watching those images out of Kabul and Afghanistan this week, what did you think?
Kia ora, Jack. So awesome to be back here in Christchurch. And, you know, worlds apart from what's happening over there in Kabul right now. I personally have six family and friends over there currently literally at the gates of Kabul airport trying to get on one of the Australian or New Zealand DF planes. And, you know, like I said in that piece, it's like you're watching their house burning and here you are on the footpath watching it, and there's no firefighters coming. So it's a tragic, tragic time.
Abbas, not only do you personally come from a refugee background, but you've studied security studies at Georgetown. Why do you think Afghanistan fell so quickly to the Taliban?
You know, there are so many elements and factors that come to play there. I mean, a mix of internal and external. I know we here in the West always focus on, you know, American imperialism and all the rest of it. And that, you know, has some legitimacy to it. But there, Afghanistan also has a raft of internal and domestic issues. It's never, you know, yesterday, we celebrated 100 years of Afghan independence, 100 years to the day. And in that time, Afghanistan has never felt as a nation. There's been no sense of nationhood, which is why it has always encountered the troubles that it has. Yeah. That country has endured 5 decades of conflict and now probably entering a sixth, and it is a tragic cycle. I think the collapse of the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces was a mix of incredible overconfidence by American intelligence agencies and the military over there to say, yes, we can win this war. But I think that that was a complete overestimation.
I hate to use sporting analogies for something like this, but I wondered in watching those images this week, given all the resourcing that has gone into the Afghan National Security Forces over the last 20 years, is it simply a case of the Taliban wanting it more?
That's right. I think the Taliban do want it more, but you have to understand a certain sector of Afghan society support the Taliban. You know, it is not a complete wall up against them. That they do have support on the ground over there. We also can't underestimate the impact and the motivations of other countries in the region, particularly across the border in Pakistan, who have actively trained and armed those Taliban militias. I mean, by and large, those people that you see on TV marching into Afghanistan, marching into Kabul, those are Pakistani nationals, and they should be treated as such. But at the same time, you have to admit what happened when the American troop withdrawal occurred. You had an incredible collapse in morale amongst the Afghan National Army. You had air support completely taken away, and as well as those civilian and military contractors that maintained Afghan National Air Force's airstrike capability. So when you have all of that, morale collapses, and that is why you have so many soldiers who say, well, we can either be killed or tortured at the hands of the Taliban, or we could perhaps surrender and let our governor strike a deal with them in order to let us live. And that is what happened over the course of 3 weeks.
Is that the same reason that the Taliban enjoy the legitimacy they enjoy? Is that the same reason that a certain percentage of the Afghan population supports them?
That's right. I think, you know, it's all very well and easy to say that these folks are coming, you know, are not wanted. But you have to admit that a certain section of society do support them, mostly because perhaps the government prior, the Ghani and the Karzai government before them, didn't have the support of the public, largely due to the endemic corruption taking place at all levels of society.
At the moment, the New Zealand government is working to get Afghans who worked with our military and police safely out of the country. What more should New Zealand be doing?
first and foremost, the thought is rightfully, with those New Zealanders, New Zealand passport holders and New Zealand visa holders who are currently trapped in Kabul. And I applaud the Prime Minister and others who are working extremely hard to get them off the ground. In the short to medium term beyond that, though, as you can see, Afghanistan is in incredible trouble. And so beyond that, I'm calling for the New Zealand government to take in an emergency intake of Afghan refugees. This can be done, and it has been done, as well as it was under the Key government in 2015 when they improved an emergency intake of Syrian refugees. There is precedent for this, and there is capability within our government to do so. I understand that there are conversations happening behind the scenes for this to take place, and I'm confident that this government will make the right decision.
Just give us a bit more detail there, Abbas. Like you say, there is a precedent here. The government took in an emergency intake of, I think, 600 Syrian refugees. But what makes Afghanistan stand out to you? Why are refugees in Afghanistan any more deserving of a new life in New Zealand than refugees in Yemen or Myanmar or Ethiopia or anywhere else?
You know, that is a fantastic question. The concept of fairness and a fair go is so entrenched in this society. But think about it this way. We have all seen those harrowing images of people climbing onto the tarmac, climbing onto the planes, holding onto the wings of planes and falling to their deaths. The situation there is just indescribably difficult. And so given New Zealand's connection and commitment to the Afghan conflict there, there is a moral responsibility. I watched an interview last week with former Defence Minister Wayne Mapp, and he said exactly the same thing, that we cannot shirk our responsibility. A former government once said that it is the price of being in the club. But at the same time, the price of being in the club also means that there is a duty of responsibility to those folks on the ground, particularly those men and women who have helped our guys on the ground come back to safety. And I don't think that there is any middle of the road New Zealander who would argue against that. And that is also a fair go.
What do you think New Zealand achieved in Afghanistan?
You know, it's very well and easy to look at the cost, both in blood and treasure, of our commitment in Afghanistan. You know, 10 deaths, $300 million spent. And you say, what was it all for? You know, there's a part of me that also angles towards that. But at the same time, when you look at the immense difference made, particularly with the provincial reconstruction teams in Bamiyan, that cannot be underestimated. It was tangible difference to the lives of those people that our troops helped. And I think that regardless of how small it was, that is measurable and that is meaningful. I mean, at its height, when there were more than 130,000 international troops in Afghanistan, New Zealand committed about 400. That was at its peak, down to about 140, and then finally the elite SAS units. And each of those, I mean, there were countless operations that they took part in. And while I'm here, I guess, addressing to the nation, I think I want to thank RNZDF personnel for that commitment.
Abbas, finally, what do you think will happen in Afghanistan in the coming months when those foreign troops finally leave?
Man, I think if there's something that history has taught us, it is that trying to predict what happens in Afghanistan is a fool's game. In the short to medium term, my thoughts are with those people on the ground around Kabul airport that are just trying to get to safety. And that is where my focus will be. And I hope that Kiwis and this government will assist in every way possible. When the news cycle moves on from what's happening in Afghanistan, I hope that people understand the desperation that people are in. And that is why the story and after the Tampa is so relevant and so important.
All right.
I think one last word, Jack, if I can get it in. I hope that, in reading that book, but also in maintaining these stories, I hope that Kiwis can look back and see, these guys just want a safety, the ability to thrive in a foreign land, just as we did 20 years ago. And I think that is more than doable.
On that note then, thank you very much for your time, Abbas. We really appreciate it. That is Abbas Nazari. And of course, we hope that Abbas's family and friends near Kabul Airport are able to find safe passage.